In 1971, Timothy Leary had an epiphany during a tarot reading that utilized a set of cards designed by Crowley. His revelation? That he was Crowley reborn and was to complete the work Crowley began, preparing humanity for cosmic consciousness. Leary acknowledged this powerful connection with the great beast in a letter to Wilson, observing that the coincidences, synchronicities between my life and his are embarrassing. From this connection flowed frequent references to Crowley, his philosophy, and their common destinies in Leary's writings and speech.
Well, I've been an admirer of Aleister Crowley. I think that I'm carrying on much of the work that he started over 100 years ago, and I think the 60s themselves. You know, Crowley said he was in favor of finding your own self and do what thou wilt shall be the whole of the law under love. It was a very powerful statement. I'm sorry he isn't around now to appreciate the glories that he started.
The phrase, do what thou wilt, was taken from the Book of the Law, Crowley's most renowned work and one whose composition is worth understanding in the context of our study. While visiting Egypt in 1904, Crowley's first wife, Rose, began going into spontaneous trances, muttering things like, they are waiting for you, and he who was waiting was Horus. Intrigued, Crowley and Rose went to visit the Cairo Museum. From a distance, she spied a glass case and exclaimed, there, there he is. Upon inspection, the case did contain an image of Horus painted on a wooden stele. But what particularly stunned Crowley was its exhibit number, 666, his number, the number of the beast. Convinced now that something supernatural was happening, Crowley went back to his hotel and performed a ritual, summoning this higher power. Over three successive days, beginning on April 8th, the book was channeled through Crowley while in a trance. And the content of this revelation? I am the snake that giveth knowledge, the spirit said. To worship me, take wine and strange drugs, whereof I will tell my prophet. Falling on precisely the wrong side of the Bible's account concerning the fall of man and Satan's role, this snake spirit begins the revelation by telling man that he is a god, that reality is essentially an illusion, sin a myth, and that ethically there's no greater commandment than the law of Thelema, Greek for will, as famously stated in the 40th verse of chapter 1.
Do what thou wilt shall be the whole of the law.
We do what we want to do when we want to do it.
Today, that same law has been written, spoken, or sung about by more contemporary artists than even Robert Anton Wilson would have imagined. John Lennon, Jim Morrison, the Black Crowes, Chris Robinson, and Marilyn Manson have all trotted it out in one form or another as words to live by. Harry Smith inserted it into the original handbook that came with his renowned anthology of American folk music. It shows up in songs by Mudvayne. David Bowie, The Only Ones, The Electric Hellfire Club, Alphaville, Throbbing Gristle, Numb, Ancient Ceremony, Eddie and the Hot Rods, Death SS, Theater of Tragedy, Cult Disciples, Therion, Psychic TV, Celtic Frost, Bruce Dickinson, Moonspell, Graham Bond, Sepultura, Edge of Sanity, The Lords of the New Church, and Marilyn Manson, among others. The band 311 not only uses Crowley's Law as a lyric, the bass player had it tattooed on his leg, as well as Crowley's Tree of Life design on his back. Punk band Unwritten Law had Crowley's Law written on their concert t-shirts.
I'm closer to the golden dawn, immersed in Crowley's uniform of imagery.
Among rock artists who have studied and embraced aspects of Crowley's magical system, Daryl Hall, Sting, Coil, and Killing Joke, among many others, could relate at some point in their careers to Bowie's comment, "My overriding interest was in Kabbalah and Crowleyism, the whole dark and rather fearsome neverworld of the wrong side of the brain." Director Donald Kamel, the man behind the underground film Performance, used to enjoy telling friends that, as a child, he would sometimes be bounced on the knee of the wickedest man in the world. Significantly, the film starred the Stones' Mick Jagger and Anita Pallenberg, herself a devoted occultist, and explored nihilism and insanity through the metaphor of rock and roll.
The only performance that makes it, that really makes it, that makes it all the way, is the one that achieved madness, right?
Kamel also played the role of Osiris in Lucifer Rising, the film by another Crowley devotee, Kenneth Anger. Anger directed and produced a number of occult films that utilized the talents of rockers Marion Faithfull, Mick Jagger, Jimmy Page, and Bobby Beausoleil, another Crowleyite who was later convicted of murder in relation to the Manson cult. And Led Zeppelin's Jimmy Page's fascination with the great beast is so notorious, it rates its own link on a website dedicated to Crowleyana. From studying magic as an adolescent, purchasing Crowley's old house, buying an occult bookstore and naming it after a periodical Crowley published, inscribing Do What Thou Wilt onto the runoff vinyl for the first pressing of Led Zeppelin III, even acting out rituals on stage that look an awful lot like those described by the beast in his, quote, instructions to his magical order. Page meant it when he said, "I've employed his system in my own day-to-day life." While few artists have shown the same level of dedication to Crowley's life and philosophy as Page, or the members of Coil, or any number of satanic metal bands, there's one sense in which Crowley's legacy has become central to the spirit of most of rock and roll. We'll discuss this in more detail in part 8 of this series, but for now understand that his primary message was simply, find your true will and then do it.
Thou hast no right but to do thy will. Do that, and no other shall say nay. Every man and every woman is a star.
Which, when you boil it down, really means,
there is no God but man.
This is not to say literally that there's no God. Satan knows there is, as do all men, if but just deep in their hearts. The crux of Crowley's demonic creed was just that each individual has no higher authority than their own will, that we are free to live life as we please. And this was the lie that the serpent hissed in the garden, and the deception that has become the siren chorus that floats through the world of popular music. Well, listen carefully, because everything we've examined in this series has been leading up to this very point. The reason so many people reject the charge of Satan worship is because, as we saw earlier, They have a caricature of the devil and his religion in their minds. He's the horned-headed demon in red pajamas, and serving him, should he even exist, would involve sacrificing babies, drinking blood, or something else equally horrible or bizarre. In reality, though, following Satan is far more mundane and universal than most people realize or would care to admit.
But I can do anything that I want to. I can pursue any kind of lustful desires that I might feel. I can engage in any activities that are so-called sinful activities and not really worry about any ecumenical councils making it right for me to do these things.
Living for, as I've said, all of the earthly and carnal pleasures.
A satanic world is a world reborn in purity, a world where the instinct and the intellect will be complementary to one another rather than being at odds with one another. It will be a world in which we follow laws of nature instead of just the rules that man's made up to regulate his conduct.
All right, we got one rule. There are no rules. Have a good time. Do what we want.
Now, if a Christian said to you, you were just really worshiping yourself, what would you say?
In a sense, they would be right. It is a form of self-worship.
We feel that there is no reason why these people shouldn't just flip the coin completely over and simply call themselves what religion has called them for many, many years. Call them devil worshippers or disciples of evil or Satanists. Of course, it's very hard for a person to hang an uncomplimentary label on themselves. And for this reason, for many years, there will be people practicing Satanism as good Christians or other religions, and they will instinctively pursue the very same things that we are, as they always have.
As we've already seen, Satan is an invisible spirit and a master of disguise. His ability to pass himself off as an angel of light can fool the rebellious and the spiritually naive into thinking that black is white, truth a lie, and even that God himself is the one telling them these things. And as for following the devil, many that espouse an openly satanic worldview can tell you that it's nothing like the Hollywood caricature. And that's precisely what makes it so disturbing, as the occult magazine Gnosis acknowledged. If there's anything horrifying in its teachings, it's that these are the principles by which most people live most of the time, usually without admitting it even to themselves. And just what is this core principle by which most people live? Well, in a nutshell, do what you want. Surprised? Well, Anton Lavey wasn't. He understood precisely from where this popular concept had arisen.
And he must, as a Satanist, knowing this, realizing what his human potential is, eventually, and here is one of the essential points of Satanism, attain his own Godhead in accordance with his own potential. Therefore, each man, each woman, is a god or goddess. Satanism.
Big Pimpin' really, man, is living life to your fullest potential. I mean, like, whatever you want to do, when you want to do it, but in the grandest way possible, you know?
And for a god or goddess, what's the ultimate standard for ethics, meaning, purpose, and destiny? You've got it. Whatever you feel is right.
My heart is the ruler of all my being. If my heart tells me it's true, that's good enough for me.
The answers to your problems are in yourself and not in a god or a religion.
Marilyn Manson noted the universality of the satanic ethic when he observed, "The idea of Antichrist is an unspoken knowledge that every person has. It's just the acceptance of yourself as a powerful being who can make their own decisions. It's not someone with a 666 on their head." And Satanism is about worshiping yourself, because you are responsible for your own good and evil.
What would you define being a Satanist as?
Worship of themselves. You're worshiping yourself when you worship Satan.
Aleister Crowley stated it this way in his infamous Book of the Law. Every man and every woman is a star or a god. And as we saw earlier, do what thou wilt shall be the whole of the law.
I'm basically a free thinker. Whatever anybody wants to do, they can do whatever they want as long as it doesn't hurt other people.
I live by myself, you know. I live by my own values and all that, morals. I set my own ways.
How do you determine what those morals and values are?
Well, I just do what's right for myself.
By declaring that each person should walk in their own light, discover and then do their true will, Lavey, Manson, and Crowley, along with Nietzsche and others, have simply been echoing the father of all lies, the one that goes back to the very dawn of human history. Then the serpent said to the woman, God knows that in the day you eat of it, your eyes will be open and you will be like God, knowing good and evil. Satanism then, in its essence, is simply each person looking through his or her own eyes for meaning and direction. As our own God or goddess, we're free to do as we will. Theologically, this worldview can be reduced to a single precept found in the fourth chapter of the Book of Satan.
Say unto thine own heart, I am mine own redeemer.
Or, to put it in more common terms, the, quote, triumphant strains, end quote, of a song that Lavey and his disciples viewed as one of the most satanic of the 20th century.
I did it my way. For what is a man? What has he got? If not himself.
It's no mere coincidence that this song, in its successive incarnations, revealed artists who became living metaphors for the inevitable downward spiral of any culture that embraces I did it my way theology. I did it my way, indeed.
Of course, not every follower of the Satanic Law ends up dying, as did Elvis and Sid, of a drug overdose. Hell does have its trophies on this side of the grave. But the ultimate expression of sin's wages for everyone who, quote, does it their way, and that includes some of the most talented and beautiful among us, is a grace-forsaken darkness that waits just on the other side of death.
And while Elvis and Sid may represent the figurative alpha and omega of the rock milieu, this my way ethic has expressed itself in so many ways by so many different performers.
And I want to do it my way, to sound like Frank Sinatra.
And in so many songs, interviews, and concert performances, one could easily argue that Do What Thou Wilt defines the very soul of rock and roll.
Wanna do
and seek your truth.
Oh, I am what I am. I'll do what I want.
Do what you want. Go on, do what you want.
Do what I want, cause I can. And if I don't, because I wanna. Do what you want to do. There ain't no rules, it's up to you.
Once a kid can click this switch in his head and say, I can do what I wanna do, I'm here on this earth, there are laws, but I'm going to handle it my way. Gained identity.
The bitch with a flashlight.
Do anything you want to do.
Do what you want.
Do it, boy. Do what you want to do.
You can do what you want to
do. Do what you want to
do. Do what you want to do.
So do what you must. Do what you can.
Do what thou wilt often resonates in the words of the popular mantra, do your own thing.
And the thing is, whatever is good for you is the best for you, you know. It's a simple thing, but people don't understand
that. Doing your own thing means doing your own thing, not right. Doing exactly what everybody else is doing, but doing what suits you.
Let me hear you say it's my thing. It's your thing.
It can provide the foundation for the ever-popular believe or trust in yourself.
The only way to find true happiness is to that old self, be true to yourself.
When I say be a soldier, I mean being true to the game, being true to yourself and believing in yourself.
The truth is all within yourself.
And the Satanic Law can find its most perfect and enticing expression in what has become one of our culture's most popular credos, follow or trust your heart.
Trust your heart, let fate decide to guide these lives we see.
What feels so right? Just trust your heart, and you'll see the light.
To your heart, you must be true to your heart.
Do trust your heart.
Follow your heart. Oh, nothing else.
I have come this far with a true.
From acceptance speeches
to follow our heart
to Broadway musicals.
Follow my heart, but to where?
To wherever your heart tells you to go.
To children's videos.
When you follow your heart.
This flake of feel-good wisdom has become the great law, the only politically correct commandment for a culture wherein truth is relative.
Truth is whatever you believe is right.
Man is good, and God is whatever you want him, her, or it to be.
Truth is, there are no absolute truths. I mean, even God doesn't work that way.
But think for just a moment. Aren't most or even all the things that people say and do determined ultimately by the desires of their hearts?
We're bored with the concept of right and wrong.
Without some absolute standard of right and wrong, what's to keep a cute children's song? From becoming the score for man's descent into lust, murder, and anarchy.
When there's people in your life trying to tell you what is right, what do you do?
Listen to your heart.
anything I want to you people at any time I want to.
You gotta listen to your heart.
As we saw earlier in this series, the reason this do what you want, it's your thing, follow your heart theology is wrong, and ultimately even satanic, is because our hearts and minds have been profoundly deranged by the effects of sin. The heart of man is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? Every way of a man is right in his own eyes. There's a way that seems right to a man, but its end is the way of death. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not to your own understanding. And perhaps most direct of all, he who trusts in his own heart is a fool. From mankind's fall from grace to virtually every evil ideology that has blighted this travailing planet, ignoring our Creator's commands and doing instead what seems right in our own eyes and hearts, has been the fountain from which sin and its wages have flowed.